Hill Teachers at Home. I'm Marlo Artist, and I'm the moderator of the program. Tar Heel Teachers at Home is a video cast focused on engaging North Carolinians in conversations around education. Each week, I'm happily joined by a wonderful panel of educators, each one representing a particular subsection of education. We'll start our introductions with our elementary school panelists.
Hi, my name's Amy Tart. I teach fifth grade math and science for Clay County Schools. You can find me on Twitter at Cards for Scholars.
Hi, I'm Justin Parmenter. I'm a seventh grade language arts teacher in Charlotte, North Carolina at Waddell Language Academy, and I'm on Twitter at Justin Parmenter.
Hello and happy holidays. My name is Micah Tweetmeyer. I'm a biology teacher at Riverside High School in Durham, and you can follow me on Twitter at Micah J. Hunter.
Good evening. My name is Dyson Passion. I am an equity specialist for Chapel Hill Carborough City Schools. You can find me on social media at Mr. D. Passion. I am also running for Board of Education in Alamance County, and you can follow our campaign at Elect Passion.
Wonderful. And we hope that each of you will follow the Tar Heel Teachers on our social media platforms. Please follow us on Twitter. Our handle is Tar Heel Teachers. You also can like our Facebook page, Tar Heel Teachers. Subscribe to our YouTube channel, and on all of our social media platforms, please use our hashtag, Tar Heel Teachers. For this episode of Tar Heel Teachers at Home, we have the great pleasure of speaking with North Carolina House Representative Craig Horn. Craig Horn is serving and representing in Union County, and he also is in his fifth term in the General Assembly. He recently announced that he is running for North Carolina State Superintendent. He has served as the chair of the North Carolina House Education Committee and the North Carolina House Education Appropriations Committee while being in the General Assembly. So please welcome to Tar Heel Teachers at Home, Representative Craig Horn.
Thank you very much for allowing me to be on this program. I look forward to hearing the questions and engaging in the discussion.
We're really excited to have you here, Representative Horn. So you just announced last week, formally announced, we've had a lot of speculation over the last several weeks that you were going to run for state superintendent. Tell us why you decided to pursue this position.
Well, it was a difficult decision, no question. I have been, as you mentioned, been involved with education policy and education appropriations now for about 8 years in the General Assembly. Although I don't come from an education background, I found a passion that I never knew I had. Passion for progress for kids and equity in education, as well as support for our teachers. I volunteered in schools for a number of years and was really put off by how the teachers were treated, often by parents and others in the community, and just really bothered me, and it was one of the motivations to get involved in public life. I moved to North Carolina in 2005 to chase grandchildren. That doesn't always work out so well because grandchildren get older, and now all of my grandkids are either already graduated from college or are just finishing up their college. I have one that's a sophomore in college, the rest are juniors and seniors, or graduated. So I was anxious to help more. Quite frankly, the political environment in not just in North Carolina, across the nation, has been bothersome to me. We spend an awful lot of time throwing each other under the bus, and I'm very frustrated with that. I want to focus on outcomes for kids. I'm not interested in placing blame or wagging fingers. So I felt, and friends of mine felt, that I could more properly pursue my desires in education if I would run for superintendent. What I think I bring to the party is a demonstrated ability to, by and large, bring people of disparate views and, in fact, sometimes opposing political ideologies together to focus on challenges and come up with mutually acceptable solutions. The legislature's been the most difficult challenge of my life, and I've had some interesting challenges in my life, but it's a fear of failure has never been a deterrent, so off we go.
So, Representative Horn, what do you say to those individuals who feel like the state superintendent should have experience as an educator?
Well, I think there's a lot of credibility to that assertion. I'm sometimes embarrassed at my lack of education, but let me turn that coin around, and I'll use a personal story. I'm 19 years old, graduated from high school, I joined the service. I found myself 6,000 miles from home, married, with a child on the way. I deeply appreciated my strong K-12 education, which helped me a lot. I didn't have many places to turn for advice, so I looked back on and depended on. I know the value of a strong K-12 education. I know how important it is. And I'm going to suggest that there are thousands and probably across this country, millions, not probably, millions of kids in my same position. I think a strong K-12 education is the very backbone of our society. And I want to see and I want to help teachers and kids attain the same level of confidence and professionalism as I was able to attain in my own life.
What questions do we have for Representative Horn?
I can go first. Representative Horn, you were one of the elected officials at the two-day summit on student safety and well-being, a call to action. Research that was presented at that meeting showed that increasing the number of mental health professionals and support staff and softening law enforcement measures actually make schools safer. When you presented your recommendations as a member of the school safety committee, you advocated for a small increase in the number of support staff and a substantial increase in the amount of funding for school resource officers. Why did you choose to advocate for measures that were not recommended by the summit or backed up by the current research?
Well, respond to that. When you say I advocated for, I would say that the committee advocated for. That was a decision of the committee. I will depend on or lean on how I performed on that committee. What did I have to say on the committee? One of the challenges that anyone has in elective office is that you can advocate for lots of positions during the debate process, but at the end of the debate, it's the decision of both the chair and the committee in general as to what position they're going to take. And that doesn't necessarily reflect what position an individual member of the committee takes. Now, one might say, well, that's a cop-out. Maybe it is, but it's also reality. There are a lot of things the legislature has done that I advocated, quite frankly, in the opposite direction. But at the end of the day, the legislature did what it did, and it's in my lap. I've got to make the best case I can. In this particular case, what you're talking about, as you mentioned, the two-day seminar, as well as the number of hearings that we had across the state, clearly showed the importance of increasing mental health professionals in our schools. I've talked about that consistently over most of the time I've been in the General Assembly. I have, as a matter of fact, I asked on a number of occasions, where's the data that showed increasing the presence or the use of school resource officers actually improves school safety? I never found that data. Now, a lot of people think, well, that was the thing to do. Most of my colleagues in the legislature felt that was the thing to do. But I pretty consistently spoke up for and, in fact, proposed a significant expansion in mental health and physical health personnel in our schools. The challenge, you all know, you all have to face it. We ask teachers to do way too much, and then we complain that you aren't teaching kids. This is ridiculous. Part of my frustration of being in the legislature, I'm one of 120 members of the House, 170 members of the General Assembly. Now, I am what I am. I've learned a lot on how to advocate for positions, how to get things accomplished. I haven't always been successful at it, but it's never deterred me from trying. So I would say to you, I have a demonstrated record of supporting school resources, in particular for social work, for school psychologists. I even received an award from the North Carolina School Psychologists Association for my work in promoting the interests of school psychologists in our schools. So I'm proud of my own track record. I'm not necessarily proud of what we've always what we've accomplished in the General Assembly.
Thank you.
Representative Horn, do you mind speaking on your thoughts on master's pay for teachers, how you feel about that in the past, and if that standpoint has changed going in the future, and if that would be something that you look into if you were to get state superintendent?
Well, here's another area where my track record's pretty clear, but the General Assembly's track record has gone in the opposite direction. I was there in 2011, 13, whatever it was, when we eliminated master's pay. And we eliminated in the face of two things. One was the state was $2.7 billion in overspent. Well, they had passed a balanced budget, but the income wasn't there to fund the balanced budget. And in fact is, it felt, as I said, $2.7 billion short. There's two things you can do when you're short of money. You can spend less or you can take in more. Well, this state was in the depths of probably the worst recession since the Great Depression. We had counties with 14% unemployment. We were broke. We couldn't even borrow money. We had to slice and dice. It was terrible. I hated every second of it, but I had to do what I had to do. In addition, we had two different studies from right here in North Carolina that clearly showed or clearly portrayed that there were no improvement in student outcomes when teachers got their master's. Mm-hmm. So here I am faced with a shortfall in money and spending money and according to Duke University, getting nothing for it. I had to make that choice. It was shortly after that I came out of a meeting right here in Union County and walked out, and there was a television crew, and they stuck a microphone in my face and they asked me about master's pay. I looked directly into the camera and said, "We screwed up." I believe that then, I believe it now, and I have consistently worked for us to reinstitute master's pay. I've made some several suggestions to our schools of higher education, including using or melding the master's program with national board certification. And I proposed in the House budget that we restore master's pay. And unfortunately, what was not in the final budget that came out of the General Assembly, and now that we have no budget anyway. So do I support master's pay? Of course, absolutely. And I have a track record of having done so.
Justin?
Representative Horn, thank you for being on the show with us tonight. I wanted to ask you about your virtual pre-K pilot that you proposed in the spring. And for anybody who's not aware, there was a proposal to establish a pilot. I believe it would have spent $1 million or $1.5 million, and it would have put 4-year-olds in North Carolina who are living below the poverty line, rather than providing access for them to attend a pre-K program, it would have provided them with hardware and software to watch videos in their home. At the time, Representative Horn, I listened to comments that you made to your colleagues in the Education Committee saying that this wasn't intended to be a replacement for pre-K. It was intended for people who wouldn't have attended pre-K anyway for a variety of reasons, and you listed several. I was really interested in that and in why, rather than trying to understand what the obstacles are to pre-K, why you were pursuing this other avenue instead. And so I reached out to somebody in DHHS. I spoke with a fiscal analyst there about what are some of the obstacles to pre-K that our families face. She said, "Well, we've really never done any research on that." She said, "One of them is likely to be transportation. And we would love it if the legislature would ask us to study how much it would cost to provide transportation to families that just can't get their children to a pre-K program. They've never asked for that." And so I guess my question for you is, in the view of this approach of trying to provide a cheap online alternative to children instead of being willing to figure out what the real problem is, do you feel like that's an appropriate That's an appropriate approach to take. And I guess my question also would be, for your great-grandchildren, would you be satisfied with them going to pre-K on a computer rather than fighting for them to have access to legitimate pre-K?
Well, Justin, you and I've had quite a number of exchanges on this particular issue, not directly, indirectly through the media. And I think that you have characterized my proposal quite inappropriately. So let me try to rephrase it and still address everything that you just brought up. First of all, I'm going to say to you that I'm advised that we have thousands of kids in this state without, not only without access to pre-K, but even if they did have access, that is, there were pre-K slots, or even if there was transportation, there are still thousands of kids that would not take advantage of NC pre-K. Now, you say that I offered it in place of, and I'm going to suggest to you that I offered it in addition to. I have been a strong advocate of early education since I came to the General Assembly. I didn't like the fact that we moved early education out of DPI and moved it to DHHS, but at the time, we didn't have any money at DPI. The only place that had money, because they had federal money, was DHHS, and that's why we moved it over there. But there are thousands of kids in this state that would not be able to take advantage of NC Pre-K or Smart Start, even if all the slots were available. So what are we supposed to do with those kids? Throw them away? And I say, no, we've got to find a way to help those kids every bit as much as we have to continue to work very hard to expand access to NC Pre-K, face-to-face NC Pre-K for everyone. Now, there's another challenge that we also have in early education, and that is parental engagement. The data is crystal clear about the importance of parental engagement in early education. Parents reading to their kids, if nothing else. The data is incredibly clear about the outcomes that one can attain from parental engagement. Matter of fact, I had a great discussion with the folks in Washington, D.C. that are involved in the early literacy program, a fellow named Ralph Smith, who heads up the National Center for Grade Level Reading, who is a big fan of the Upstart program that I was proposing for North Carolina. And what that Upstart program does is it requires parental engagement. It provides advice and coaching to parents and kids, and includes some, very little, online interaction that results in taking education to kids when the kids can't get to education. So rather than throw these kids away, which is, I shouldn't probably use that phrase, but that's the result. Rather than not providing or affording these kids an opportunity to engage with their parents and get coaching and help them learn to read and learn to the appreciation of education at the earliest age and prepare them for kindergarten, I propose that we pilot this program that has proven benefit based on outcomes in other states, and not just one other state, but another number of other states, as well as I was exposed to data that showed the efficacy of this program. So it is a parental involvement program. Now, sadly, and it's my fault, I let this thing get away from me insofar as being called virtual pre-K. Well, that's really the very smallest part of the program. Yes, it was a million, wasn't a million and a half, it was $1 million. And I thought $1 million would be well spent rather than some of the other crazy things the legislature does in order to afford our poorest kids, the most underserved kids in this state, an opportunity to engage with their parents and to accomplish the goal of preparing them to start school when school became available to them. I go back to say this is not instead of, never was intended in any way, shape, or form to replace anything. It's in addition to a current program. The more we can expand young children's exposure to the education process and involve their parents, I take a look at, the other day we saw the Kennedy Center Awards and Sesame Street. I remember when the U.S. Congress tried to defund Sesame Street. that Sesame Street was an incredibly successful approach to helping kids that otherwise would not have had access. And that Sesame Street did not even require parental involvement. The program that I'm proposing and continue to support is one of parental involvement and help through the use of technology and coaches. I think it's a good investment. I think it can prove successful for North Carolina. But since I don't know that as a fact, I proposed a test. I think it's worth the try.
Representative Horn, piggybacking on that, you just spoke a lot about the lack of parental involvement in many of our young students' academic pursuits. Do you think there are some barriers that parents, especially parents of students living in poverty, that prevents them from spending that time with their students? And do you think that this program would get around some of those barriers for those parents?
Well, there are lots of barriers to parental involvement. Everything from the availability of transportation, the poverty is inherently a barrier. So how do we address all that? There's no single thing that addresses everything. There's probably no single thing that addresses any one thing. We are all a product of multiple pressures in society and in our environment. So how do we go about that? And there is no magic answer. I'd love to have a magic wand. I did have a principal once give me a magic wand. I've never been able to figure out how she turned it on, but we'll keep working on it. So those barriers are transportation, food and nutrition barriers. They are, in some cases, political barriers. And I don't mean political in the terms of partisanship. I mean political because of accessibility within certain counties that have chosen to invest more of their local resources or not, or political barriers because it's a personality thing. There are those people that inherently oppose government intervention of any kind at every level. We've got the folks that don't want kids to be vaccinated because they feel that that's a negative impact of what government can do, or there are negative impacts to come from that. It's going to take yeoman work from every viewpoint, from all of us across this state. We have some terribly underserved kids. We got to keep a focus on how do we get services for those kids and give them a good chance to achieve their goals in life. Those kids, it breaks all of our hearts. Some of you have those kids in your classrooms. I've seen a lot of those kids. Frankly, I grew up on an island in the Mississippi River. We didn't have running water. We didn't have indoor toilets. There were plenty of reasons that things didn't work. So what are we going to do about it? Do I have the magic answer? Absolutely not. One of the things I propose to do about it is bring the best minds in the country, the best minds in our state, and we've got some great people in the state. Let's sit down and figure out what are we going to do. We're not going to get it done tonight, but we can get it done. So let's start taking steps toward that. Let's start focusing on the things on which we do agree rather than the things on which we don't agree, and we'll accomplish something. And while we're accomplishing those things, we're going to be able to accomplish a few more, and that's going to open a door to another idea. We've got to get our parents on board. We've got to get our locally elected officials on board. We've got to get state people on board. There's a lot of work to be done, and it's hard. It's really hard. It's hard because sometimes it's hard because we make it hard. We're so worried about who gets credit for things. We're so concerned about who's going to be blamed for things. Well, how about we forget about those things and focus on what's going to work for a kid, any kid and every kid. It's a calling for you all. I'd like to think it's a calling for me too.
Dyson.
Representative Horn, last week I had the privilege to attend the Drive Summit, where we learned a great deal about the benefit for having a more diverse and inclusive teaching workforce. As you're aware, our teaching workforce does not reflect what our student population is. I'd like to hear your thoughts on how we could close that gap, I lost track of my question, but yeah, what are some of your thoughts on how we could build a more diverse and inclusive teaching workforce?
Well, I too was at the Drive Summit. I stayed for most of the day. I had to break away for a while. I came back and then I had to leave again. And James Ford and I have had a long-standing relationship, long-standing, since he was still teaching at Garinger High School. And our relationship has been built very much on how do we bring more teachers of color, particularly male teachers of color, into the classroom. It's been kind of a thing of mine before I first met James, because it's the first subject I brought up to him. The data is crystal clear about how kids respond to people that look like them and talk like them. We've got to do this. This isn't a kind of like to. We've got to do it. James Ford's study, wasn't just his study, but the study of erasing inequities in education. I don't know if you saw it, but I also published a review of the study where he clearly pointed out how we have failed so many kids of color in this state. And that's resulted in, over the years, us not having people of color in the classroom. And when I say in the classroom, I'm talking about up in front of the classroom, teachers of color. So what are we going to do about it? We need to, first of all, kick up our programs everywhere we go. We need to be very conscious of the decisions we're making. When I worked with Profound Gentleman Group here in the Charlotte area, very impressed with those guys. And Mario, one of the guys with Profound Gentleman, pointed out to me something that I had never really thought about before. He said, you know, our schools of education are designed for white women. Well, that never even really occurred to me. Shame on me. But he's right. He's absolutely right. It's been brought up a couple of times since then. So what are we doing about that? I have begun in the last year or so to work with some of our schools of education. As you know, we brought back teaching fellows of sorts. It's a different kind of a different approach than we had before. It's got more money in it. When I say more money, it's got more money per student that would take up teaching, but it has also narrowed the field for what they will teach. And it's also not included our HBCUs. Not happy with that at all. Trying to figure out how to get that accomplished. I've met with some of the folks at some of the HBCUs on how do we kick up their program, because the teaching fellows group tells me that their review of the teacher prep programs at our HBCUs were not sufficiently rigorous for them to utilize these HBCUs in our teaching fellows program. Now,
can you share with us Representative Horn, can you share with us which indicators they actually looked at when they made that statement that the teacher preparation programs at HBCUs were not rigorous enough? What were the indicators?
Well, and I can't tell you as I sit here this evening. I wish I could. I wasn't prepared to haul that out. And do I recall it? Not specifically. Matter of fact, I'm continue to look more deeply into how we're doing teaching fellows, because it's kind of a funny story behind that teaching fellows. When we eliminated teaching fellows, the same time we eliminated the master's pay, we didn't have any money and we were slicing and dicing. I've tried ever since then to restore teaching fellows. There were some attitudes in the General Assembly that the teaching fellows program was not all it was cracked up to be. I didn't particularly agree with that, but I think that then, and I think now, we've got to do more to get the teaching fellows program coming back on track. But since there was this attitude, I worked with a group of teachers and we created a STAR program, the Scholarship for Teacher Recruitment and Retention. not a recruitment, something that begins with an A. But anyway, we call it NC Star. So I tried to get that into the budget 4 years ago and was met without any cooperation from my friends in the other house. So I'm sat down with President Pro Tem of the Senate, Senator Berger, and his staffers to figure out, okay, what can we do and what do we need to do? And Senator Berger promised me that in the following year, he would work with me on NC Star. And he appointed a senator to be his go-to person on that. Well, I waited a while, and then I finally got a call from that particular senator, who's not in the Senate any longer, saying he heard that Senator Berger told me that he had agreed that we would proceed with this new project. He said, but I don't want to call it NC Star. I want to call it Teaching Fellows. I kind of laughed and to myself, and I said, oh, no, I don't want to do that. You guys have already talked me out of Teaching Fellows because you're so opposed to it, so I want to stick with NC Star. Well, that, of course, made them want it even more. That's kind of how the negotiating process works, I guess. So anyway, I knew I had to get something. I wasn't coming away empty-handed. We came back with Teaching Fellows, focusing on STEM, and to create a Teaching Fellows unit that would select a few schools to begin with. I proposed in the House budget that we expand the number of schools this year in Teaching Fellows. It didn't make it into the final budget, but I think we are seeing now, as a result of the good work of James Ford, you guys, and a lot of other people across this state, the importance of expanding Teaching Fellows. Now, I'm not sure what the Teaching Fellows people met by the fact that the HBCU teacher prep programs were not sufficiently rigorous. Frankly, I don't recall what they told me about that. So I went out to I haven't gotten to them all. I met with NC Central as an example to talk about this very thing. Trying to figure out what do you have to do or what do they think they need to do and what can I do to help them kick it up. I think that's the phrase I use. It got quoted someplace. Kick it up and let's get Teaching Fellows, because we have to have teachers of color in our schools and we have to have them quickly. So it's a work in progress. I know I'm taking an awful long time to answer your question. I'm sorry.
Well, let me ask you this follow-up question. So if the students of color who are admitted to the Teaching Fellows program have to follow the same requirements as students who attend a HBCU, as the same ones who would attend a PWI, do you think that we will be putting out and being able to make sure we have educators of color who are in fact effective and able to serve, especially if they're receiving the same professional development that the other students will receive in Teaching Fellows, the same leadership experiences? If they have that same requirement and that same eligibility, what would prevent them from being just as effective in the classroom?
Well, your first question is, do I think that they can do this? Sure, I think they can. I think they are in many cases already doing it. I'm not sure what the challenges are. More likely they're political, more political than anything. Frankly, I also voiced my concern about some of the institutions we've already chosen. To a good start. New teacher support, I'm very pleased with how that program is working. I've been a strong supporter of that since the beginning of it. But I'm not so sure we have a sufficiently broad mentoring program for all of our new teachers coming into the classroom. Most of the principals that I talk to, I ask them, are teachers coming out of school prepared for your classroom today? And most of them say, no, they're not prepared for my classroom today. I have challenged the chancellor, not chancellor, the deans of a number of our schools of education in this state. I made a speech to a group of them in that were assembled in Rouyn-Salisbury earlier this year and said, you guys aren't doing your job. You're not preparing your students for a 21st century classroom. You're preparing for an early 20th century classroom. I wasn't the most popular guy in the room, as you can imagine, when I challenged those deans to that extent. But they are now finding that perhaps there was something to what I said. We are changing our teacher prep programs, and we are changing our principal prep programs, not fast enough and not strongly enough. We're in the process. The pressure coming from you all, each one of you individually, and you as groups, is contributing to those changes. Keep it up. You're doing a great job. Beat the crap out of us. Make sure that we are paying attention and that we are moving forward, because it's, for all practical purposes, it's already too late. So we got to pick up the pace.
Other questions for Representative Horn?
I've got one more question. Representative Horn, I have a question about the Strengthening Educators Pay Act, which was vetoed by Governor Cooper. That bill would have given no raise at all to teachers in years 0 through 15 for our hardworking non-certified staff, our custodians, cafeteria workers, bus drivers. Many of them would have seen less than $5 a month increase in pay as a result of that bill. Looking at the vote totals, I noticed that you weren't present for the vote that day, but that not one Republican voted against that bill. I'm just curious how you would have voted on that bill.
Well, if you're talking about the budget bill in its entirety, I would have voted for the budget bill in its entirety. We need a budget. We need a balanced budget. We often pass bills that are, let us say, less than perfect. I've never been one to sacrifice the good for the perfect. The pay bill, the whole pay process has been a multi-year process. Going back 6 years ago at least, I remember when then Governor McCrory got about 75 teachers together from across the state, and among the various issues that they addressed was the pay issue. And these 75 teachers, by and large, came back and said, look, you guys got to do something first and foremost for our earliest teachers. You know, the floor is too low, and we are not able to bring teachers into the profession. Then you need to do something for our mid-career teachers, because they are the backbone of our teaching corps. They're the mentors to our new teachers, and they are the ones day in and day out delivering the goods. And then we can't leave our veteran teachers out of it. So then you got to come back and do that. So we did that in three different stages. This last year was stage three, where we tried to put a little more money into the veteran teachers, and we continued to increase teachers in their mid-career, but we didn't do squat for the new teachers. For teachers coming in, part of that's because we had front-loaded it so much a few years ago. Is it sufficient? I don't think there is such a thing as sufficient. I don't know what sufficient means. Sufficient may mean market rates. Well, I'm not sure how you figure out what market rates are, but it doesn't matter. We need to be paying teachers more if we're going to attract and retain quality teachers at every level. We need our veteran teachers, because they are the ones that are they probably do more mentoring than our mid-career teachers, who are quite already have their hands full. So how would I have voted on a given bill on a given day? I'm not sure why I wasn't there. I didn't even remember that I had missed that vote, but nevertheless, as I said, if the vote was about the entire budget, I would vote for the entire budget. We need a budget. The fact that right now we don't have a budget is devastating for education. It is really painful for education, more than anything else, in my opinion. And the reason it's devastating for education isn't just the teacher raises, because right now they're not getting any raises. So I got to get what I can get. Secondly, It's devastating for us in school supplies. It's devastating for us in school construction. It's devastating for us in after-school programs. It's devastating for us in scholarships. We got to have a budget, and we've got to have a budget now. If I can't get everything I want, well, what can I get? Because I can't get nothing, and right now I've got nothing, and I don't like it, and neither should any of us like it. A pox on all their houses. Yes, I understand there's lots of issues and Medicaid expansion, all these other things, but I'm telling you, and I'm telling everybody, we've got to have an education budget enacted, and we have to have it now, not in 2020, and not till May, now. I'm sorry I get so worked up about it, but it really is upsetting to me that we can't get something. Sorry.
Micah? I'm
a little carried away sometimes.
I was just going to ask Representative Horn if you've had a chance to look at the Leandro report that's come out recently, and if you have any main takeaways or things that you are going to advocate for to the General Assembly if you were elected as our state superintendent.
Well, I've spent most of the weekend trying to read the 300 plus page Leandro report, and with a lot of time spent on reading and rereading the recommendations. I'll begin on the downside, and then we'll pick it up. The first recommendation was kind of off-putting. The first recommendation was that we should continue our current financing system because everybody's used to it. And then the rest of the report goes to how we should change our current funding system. I found that counterproductive to have that, the first recommendation. I can't remember the exact words, but something to the effect that we should continue the current funding system because we're all used to it. Well, that's no reason to continue anything. But the Leandro decision, or the West Ed report on the Leandro decision, has a number of things that I strongly support and have worked hard for. Calendar flexibility, changing the grading system to reflect growth. Growth is the very definition of education. And certainly as a businessman, I understand performance. Can you do the job or not? But growth is the very definition of education. And you all more than I know how hard it is to move a kid from, in my case, perhaps an F to a C is a whole lot harder than moving a kid from a C to an A. So we've got to change the grading system. We've got to implement calendar flexibility. The Leandro report spends a bit of time talking, or the West Ed report spends a bit of time talking about the Advanced Teaching Roles Program. Well, that's my program. I believe strongly in the Advanced Teaching Roles Program. We've got to offer teachers the opportunity to grow in their profession and not force them out of the classroom. That's critically important. Teachers are teachers because they want to teach. Now, some of them, sure, have desires to move on into administration, but we shouldn't force teachers into administration in order to improve their lot in life, to improve their income. We need to give them the opportunity to do that and still stay in front of kids. We've got great teaching going on in this state, and we need to do everything we can to reward it and encourage more of it and take advantage of that great teaching in the way of mentoring and other things. So those are key pieces of the West Ed report that I will work really, really hard to implement. And I've got a track record of doing so, and I'm going to suggest to you that, in fact, as I can tell you, the House has unanimously supported calendar flex. The House, well, maybe not unanimously, I think there was one vote against it. The House has consistently supported the change to growth versus performance as the key indicator of academic success. So we've got some momentum there, and I'm going to suggest that there is a growing agreement from the folks in the House, in the Senate. The key here is, how do we get people focused to work together? How do we do that? And we don't do it by calling each other names and ragging our fingers at them. We do it by sitting down and chatting one-to-one or two-to-one but talking to each other instead of at each other. I think I can help do that. I've got a pretty good track record all my life of whether it was in the military or in business and now in the legislature, bringing people together that had a little, some different views. And we said, okay, we've got different views on how to do things, but by and large, we have the same views on what outcomes we want. And if we can focus on outcomes, we can get the cheese to the mouse instead of the mouse to the cheese. And I'm referring to that silly little, that little maze that we've all seen where we tell a kid to put a pencil on the mouse and take it to the cheese. And the kid pretty quickly figures out if you put a pencil on the cheese, it's a whole lot easier to get it to the mouse. Well, you know, that works not just with cheeses and with cheese and mice. It doesn't work just in the food business. It works in education too. And that's, how do we get the goal to the people instead of always trying to drag people to the goal? I think we can do this. I really believe we can do this. And I think I can help it happen.
Well, Representative Holm, we certainly would love for you to come on our program in the future as you continue to progress through your state superintendent campaign so that we can hear more about your platforms. What are your top three priorities before we close the show?
Well, first, the main priority is a focus on student outcomes. Student outcomes. Second priority is to enhance the opportunity for every student and every teacher to achieve their goals. We can do that through advanced teaching roles and lots of other more well thought out and proper professional development programs. When I first got to the legislature, some of the things we called professional development was nothing more than how to fill out another form or an explanation to you as to what mandate I'm going to throw on your back in addition to asking you to teach kids. So we've got to do a whole lot better, and we can. There's a lot to learn from people that are doing great work in this state and around the country. That's why I go to so many of these conferences. And then the last part is we've got to break down this distrust between the legislature and DPI, between teachers and administrators and politicians and parents. And I don't want to hear any more of the blame game. I think we've got to come together. So I think I can play a role in bringing people together. Meeting with PTAs and chambers of commerce, as well as talking to teachers, to them, not at them, working with them, listening to them. There's great teaching going on in this state. The four of you are great teachers. I know as a fact the four of you are great teachers. And there's so much we can learn from each one of you if we're willing to listen on my side of the fence. And I think that's what I can bring to the party.
Well, we certainly appreciate you coming on this program and sharing your thoughts with us. And we look forward to continuing the conversation in the new year. Happy holidays to you, Representative Horn.
Thank you very much. Thank you all for taking your time this evening. I greatly appreciate it. Continue, please, to be a strong voice for teachers and kids. Share your views. There's a little sign on my door. If you ever come to visit me, it says, please come in. Agreement not required. That's the key to it all. Agreement's not required. But by working together, we can find agreement. Thank you very much. Merry Christmas. Happy holidays to everyone.
That sounds great. Thank you so much. We also would like to thank our wonderful audience for engaging us in this program. We hope that you will follow us on Twitter. Our handle is @TarHeelTeachers. Please like our Facebook page, it's Tar Heel Teachers. Please subscribe to our YouTube channel and on all of our social media platforms, please use our hashtag Tar Heel Teachers. We'd like to thank our wonderful panel for being with us for this episode, Amy Tart, Justin Parmenter, Micah Tweetmeyer, and Dyson Passione. And once again, we'd like to thank our special guest for this episode, North Carolina State Representative Craig Horn, for being our special guest. He is running for state superintendency. We look forward to seeing you all in 2020.
Thanks very much. Good night.
Good night. Thank you.